Our Unitarian Universalist bylaws affirm six values centered in love and inseparable from each other. On the third Sunday of the season, we call to mind the third such value, justice. We work to be diverse, multicultural, beloved communities where all thrive. We covenant to dismantle racism and all forms of systemic oppression. We support the use of inclusive democratic processes to make decisions. Good morning. I am Elizabeth Williams, your celebrant this morning, and my pronouns are she, her, and hers. Welcome to the First Unitarian Church of Des Moines. Our building is located on land that has been home to humans for 12,000 years, starting with people of woodland culture, and later the Iowa, Sauk, and Meskwaki. Other animals, such as the American mastodon, extinct for 10,000 years, once roamed these lands. As we enter this space, the ghosts of humans and other animals past are among us. We are called to join in the work of education, reparation, and healing for all species. Our purpose is to associate ourselves together for the study and practice of morality and religion, as interpreted by the growing thought and noblest lives of humanity, hoping thereby to prove helpful to one another and to promote truth, righteousness, and love in the world. This bond of union is reiterated in our mission, love radically, grow ethically and spiritually, and serve justly. It's a blessing you were born. It matters what you do. Your experience of the divine is true, and you don't have to go it alone. A special welcome to our visitors. Please be sure to silence your phones, and for those of you on Zoom, thanks for tuning in, and please be sure your mic is muted. If you are here with children, there is childcare, or feel free to keep them seated with you or utilize our play area in the back. Our speaker today is Amy Landrigan, Vice President of Strategy and Venture for Central Iowa Shelter and Services. She will discuss the ways in which the organization supports community members on their journeys to better lives. She will also be today's guest for the forum in Griffin Hall, which will begin 30 minutes after the service. On the third Sunday of the season, we dedicate our chalice to our value of justice. Please join with me in the chalice lighting words from Elizabeth McMaster in your order of service. We light our flaming chalice to illuminate the world we seek. In the search for truth, may we be just. In the search for justice, may we be loving. And in loving, may we find peace.
And a hush falls over the crowd.
But please join us on the last chorus, last time through the chorus.
All right.
And if I ever lose my mouth, oh, weave, I won't have to talk.
Did it take long to find me? I asked the faithful eye. Did it take long to find me? And are you gonna stay the night?
Oh, I'm being followed by a moon shadow, moon shadow, moon shadow. Leaping and hopping on a moon shadow, moon shadow, moon shadow. Moon shadow, moon shadow.
I was so taken by the music, I almost didn't remember to come up. I'm Ann Mowry, a member of the pastoral care team. My pronouns are she and her, and?
And I'm Anna Davis Evans, also a member of the pastoral care team, and my pronouns are she, her, hers.
This church is not a building, but a community. As a community of human hands and hearts, we come together to share our laughter and our tears, and to bear witness and minister to one another as we struggle with life's sorrows and celebrate life's joys. May we hold in our thoughts and prayers this week Don Shepherd, his former wife of 30 years died recently, and Don has been going through lots of memories over this. Please share now, either out loud or in the chat, the name of those of you who are holding in your hearts. May the care of this community uphold them all. May the light of our communities shine on the broken places of the world. May the work of our hands and hearts support, aid, and comfort all those who hunger or thirst for food or water, justice or freedom. May we never look away when we are needed. May those who are grieving be comforted. May those who are tired find rest. May the broken places be healed. May those who are filled with joy and laughter be abundant. We now light three candles, one for the joys and sorrows shared, one for the names spoken, and one for all that remains unspoken but present in our hearts. Let us observe a time of silence.
Today's meditation to light the darkness and begin again. There is a glow far off in the distance, a light to which no path leads. We know that each time we help one another or join them to heal the world, each time we stand up for justice and what is right, each time we work and hope and love against all odds, A spark is created that adds to the intensity of that light. We join with others who see and turn toward the glow. As we travel toward that beacon, the underbrush of indifference is flattened and a path is created. More are led to join us, and obstacles are kicked away and a road is formed. Many approach the light strengthened by our works, and we join them to each light a candle. Although many candles are lighted, the blaze never diminishes. We travel out into the world again to light the darkness and begin again. The cycle continues, our work intensifying the glow and our joining with others to travel to the blaze and light our candles again. We continue knowing that one day we or our grandchildren or perhaps their grandchildren will no longer travel that widened and trodden path to light a candle because dawn has arrived. Justice is commonplace and poverty is vanquished and the beloved community stands illuminated in the fullness of daylight. Today's reading, A Culture of Care, is an excerpt from Defund Fear, Safety Without Policing, Prisons and Punishment by Zach Norris. There are two ways to think about safety. There is a fear-based way and a care-based way. The fear-based model defines safety only in terms of being free from crime and criminals, which is limited and limiting, what I call the framework of fear. What I call the framework of fear employs four key elements: systemic deprivation, extensive and expensive systematic suspicion, cruel punishment, and often permanent isolation from the rest of society. The framework of fear has led to the traumatization of not just the individuals who have been targeted, dehumanized, and criminalized, but the traumatization of entire communities, unfathomable devastations that will be decades in the reckoning. Because trauma is as much a chief cause of violence as the rest of violence, our current for fear-based system paradoxically generates more harm than it prevents in never-ending cycles of trauma. This moment presents the opportunity to take action toward a culture of caring and policies of caring. A culture of care prevents many harms from happening in the first place by investing in a social safety net, by building our capacity to relate to one another across differences, and by increasing our sense of skin in the game with more vibrant engagement on every level. Care-based safety also means we address harms in ways that hold people accountable and bring about healing. Safety is not tied to our capacity to watch our neighbors, but rather based on our capacity to truly look out for one another. We are safer when we act together than when we let ourselves be divided. We come now to the offering, recalling our value, justice. We work to be diverse, multicultural, beloved communities where all thrive. We covenant to dismantle racism and all forms of systemic oppression. We support the use of inclusive democratic processes to make decisions. The offering, then, is gratefully given and gratefully received.
Thank you.
was beautiful.
All right, well, good morning, everybody. Oh, I love that. Thank you so much for welcoming me here today. Again, my name is Amy Landrigan, pronouns she and her, and I'm the Vice President of Strategy and Venture at Central Iowa Shelter and Services. It's also known as CISS, in case anybody's heard it called that. I'm really honored to speak with you all today and just talk about the work we do and the way we support our community members and our neighbors. Today, we're going to explore the theme of new beginnings, surviving to thriving, and how our efforts help the community members that are going through some tough times and merely surviving, helping them get to that place in their lives where they can feel like they're thriving again and truly a part of the beautiful community we have across Central Iowa. I'm going to be reviewing a lot of our programs today. I think I've missed a few. We have about 18. And so please come to the forum after to learn more if you have any questions. Homelessness is a multifaceted issue that affects individuals and families in every community, including right here in Central Iowa, in every county. Central Iowa Shelter and Services is dedicated to providing low barrier shelter, meals, and support services at no cost to adults experiencing homelessness, while facilitating their journey towards self-sufficiency. As the largest homeless shelter in the state and the only low barrier shelter, we serve almost 20,000 unique individuals annually. What does low barrier mean? It means you can come as you are. If you're currently self-medicating with an illegal substance, if you're currently having active hallucinations, if you're currently just in a really bad mood, that's okay. You're welcome within our doors. The people experiencing homelessness are not strangers. They're our brothers, they're our sisters, they're our friends. They are individuals who have faced tremendous challenges, often beyond their control, and this has led them to their current situation. These are not bad people. They're not criminals. They are our neighbors, trying their best to survive in spite of the hardships they face. Many factors contribute to homelessness. Economic challenges such as poverty, lack of affordable housing, and unemployment often leave people with no choice but to seek shelter wherever they can find it. Social issues, including family breakdown, domestic violence, unplanned medical expenses due to lack of insurance or insurance accessibility, and the lack of support systems can have individuals without a safe place to turn. When someone doesn't have a strong network or community to lean on, it becomes incredibly difficult to get back on their feet. Systematic inequalities in healthcare, education, and criminal justice disproportionately affect marginalized communities, making it harder for them to escape the cycle of poverty and homelessness. And finally, personal challenges such as addiction, mental illness, and trauma can increase an individual's vulnerability to homelessness. These issues and more often require comprehensive, holistic support and treatment, which many people don't have access to. And that's why today I want to talk about the new beginnings we offer at CISS and how we're dedicated to helping our community members and our neighbors, again, move from merely surviving to thriving in our beautiful community. Each of our initiatives are designed to not only address immediate needs, but also empower individuals to build a better future. So first, let me talk about what we're most known for, and that's our emergency shelter and housing programs. Our shelter is open to individuals 18 and older, and we provide 150 emergency shelter beds. We are open 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, offering 90 days of stay. And I will say during weather amnesty, we usually house about 250 people. Our current average length of stay is actually 15 days, and that's because we have worked so hard to get people connected to permanent housing as quickly as we can and connected to resources and sometimes family members that may have them listed as a missing person. Our average length of stay used to be 25 days, so we're moving it right along. We'd like to get it down to 10 if possible. We have 81 single unit efficiency apartments, including 19 units specifically for veterans. These program-based apartments help individuals learn essential life skills, such as cooking, cleaning, maintaining employment. For some individuals, it's just carrying on a conversation and learning how to make eye contact again. Each apartment includes basic amenities and provides a safe space for residents. After a year, a resident can transition to community housing with Section 8 vouchers. reducing the typical wait time for housing, which is currently nearly 3 years. We also offer specific veteran programs, which I spoke about a little bit earlier. Veteran grant and per diem programs provide 19 efficiency apartments and additional case management. This program not only offers housing, but comprehensive support, ensuring our veterans have access to the resources they need to regain stability and independence. Veterans Contract Emergency Residential Program offers 5 efficiency apartments for short-term transitional housing. These individuals, the minute they get into shelter, there's no application, it's just, we're going to get you up into an apartment right away and get you connected to the VA so you can get the services you need as soon as possible. Next, we have our Mulberry Street Cafe, also known as our community kitchen, which thank you all for coming and serving and providing meals. Our community kitchen serves breakfast, lunch, dinner, and snacks daily and provides over 100,000 meals annually. These programs not only feed those in need, but they also offer wonderful job training programs. We, of course, teach culinary skills, but also we help individuals gain confidence and prepare for a brighter future. Our summer meal program provides free meals to Des Moines youth throughout the summer, ensuring no child goes hungry. These meals are completely free and they meet USDA nutritional guidelines. Regardless of the time of year, we believe all children need access to food, and that's why we also provide the Child and Adult Care Food Program, CACFP, serving meals to our neighbors of all ages throughout the year. Next is our street outreach program. Our street outreach program, they go out into the streets and work with people directly. They meet with everyone face to face, and they not only bring them resources they might need, and sometimes we try to bring hot and ready meals for them, especially in the wintertime, but we connect to people who thought they were forgotten and thought they were being ignored, and help them know that we're here for you. We can do an intake right there on the street with them and help them get the resources they need as soon as possible. We do that not just in Polk County, but in 15 other counties in Central Iowa. We also have on-site healthcare. We have a clinic that operates in partnership with Hy-Vee Health Exemplar Care, removing transportation and cost barriers. So if you come into the shelter, within 24 hours, we get you into the clinic to make sure, do you need vaccines? We often have people with open wounds that are being infected. We have some individuals that don't know they have a disease that's maybe causing them dementia. We have individuals that have a UTI or a vitamin D deficiency, and they're out on the street because people thought maybe they were demented or hallucinating, but truly they just needed a doctor's care. It's a wonderful program, and again, that is there 24 hours a day, but truly we have an EMT there as well from them. That we had an individual in the community room earlier, last month actually, have a seizure, and they ran right out, they helped them right away, and then of course we called an ambulance to assist them. So it's a wonderful program, and we very much appreciate that partnership. We also have Mulberry Farm and Food. It's one of our newer programs. It provides fresh, locally grown food to our kitchen, but also offers job training programs for our clients. Our Shane greenhouse is 3,600 square feet and capable of producing 5,500 heads of lettuce a month. Of course, 10% loss just due to environment, all that good stuff with farming. We also grow carrots, radishes, tomatoes, cauliflower, kale, and lots more. I learned what a rat tail radish was the other day. I thought it was a string bean, took a bite. I was unprepared. It was very spicy, but it was delicious. This innovative program not only supports our kitchen, but like I said, it treats valuable agricultural skills to our clients. We're actually making sure that they also get accredited in using organic pesticides, because that's something that our farmers have told us is a wonderful skill that will get them a job very quickly. That leads us into our other job training programs, which includes, like I said, the kitchen, our agricultural training program, but also janitorial and maintenance. We not only help individuals learn the skills they need to get a job, but we help them get that job. We help them update their resume, practice for their interview. If an interview goes wrong, let's talk through why. What could we have done better? Or maybe it was just what happened and how to get through that emotionally. Inside our facility, we have a clothing closet and a food pantry. These programs are open to the public, not just individuals staying at shelter. They're all donation-based, so that's donations of food and clothing given by the community. We have volunteers running those, and we also get help from AARP. And this ensures that the individuals that do come to our facility, I just dropped something, I'm not sure what that was, but we'll get it later. This helps people coming into our facility not only have, of course, the emotional and community support they need, but they might need new clothes. They often need new shoes. There is a limit to how many shirts and pants they can get a month, but you can come in anytime to get underwear, shoes, if it's weather amnesty, if it's cold outside, coats. You can get as many coats as you need out there. We want to make sure everybody has what they need to, again, not just survive, but thrive. And same with the food pantry. One wonderful thing we do is if someone is graduating, is what we call it, so they've been in their apartment, they've been there a year, they've gotten that voucher I talked about, now they're ready to go into Section 8, that can be really scary. And so we put together a basket, not only with some hygiene products, but if someone's donated maybe some kitchen supplies that we don't need in our kitchen, we'll make sure they have a frying pan, a skillet. I'm blanking on every other kitchen tool and doing this, but you guys know what I mean, a spatula, there you go. But also food and clothing. We try to get pillows to them if we can, if we have them donated, but we want to make sure that, again, this journey is one that's is as least scary as possible for these individuals. Also inside of our shelter, we offer day services. So this includes daily services that are education, training, but also we have AA and NA programs come in. We have mental health support groups, and any community organization can come in and do a training or a class for the individuals in our shelter. We also have one specific room and day services that are just for veterans. They often watch movies and shows in there. One of the reasons we do that is because we find that our veterans and our other shelter guests that are living with PTSD sometimes have reactions to media that others won't understand. And so we want to make sure they have a safe place to experience that and live out their emotions authentically and not be judged why they do it. It's a really wonderful program. Now we're going to discuss new initiatives and future plans to help our neighbors thrive. So one is the Mulberry Farm and Food Truck that just started in June. So in our greenhouse, we also grow tilapia. We harvest tilapia, and the nutrients from that water goes through and helps our produce grow. It's a really wonderful program, and again, it helps those trainees learn about hydroponics. But we sell fish tacos, and we also sell cauliflower tacos. We also have seasonal, it's all farm to table. So right now we have this really delicious Moroccan carrot with a curry yogurt and a pomegranate reduction. I didn't even know we could do that, but it's really delicious and it's fancy, but it's all from our garden. And again, we're teaching our trainees how they can make this food, which makes them a wonderful candidate to get a job. We're at multiple farmers markets, but the big thing to know is that if you go to the Ankeny, Johnston, or Altoona farmers market and you buy from our food truck, every meal you purchase, we keep track of that, and then we go to a food insecure area and we give out that many meals for free. So they're also eating those delicious Moroccan carrots that I want to learn how to make, and those fish tacos and cauliflower tacos. We also have Growth Financial Services, which is a program that assists individuals' financial goals and stability. We act as a payee for those who need it, but we don't just handle their bills, we teach them how to save money. Our program right now has more in their savings. The individuals in that program have more in their savings than the average American. So we're really trying to make sure that, again, they get out of poverty by managing their finances and learning how to do that themselves. We also have Elevate Accounting, which provides affordable financing services to nonprofits all across the state. We're eventually going to expand nationally. We know there are so many nonprofits that are doing fantastic work, but most nonprofits that are new will only last 5 to 8 years. That's mainly because of financial management. It can be very difficult to afford an administrative team, and we've been there. We've had issues with audits, and you know, 20, 15 years ago, where we only had one person managing everything, so we know what it feels like to stress about that, and we want to make sure we can help other nonprofits with their finances. So we do bookkeeping, we can do HR work for them, and what we do is we just ask for a very low cost. We talk to individuals and ask, how much can you afford? What, you know, maybe 3% of your largest grant, whatever we can do, but we're not trying to make a profit. We just want to make sure that other people doing fantastic work can continue to do that themselves as well. We also are bringing housing command centers to Ottumwa and Grinnell. So we have a housing command center in our shelter. What that means is, I've talked a lot, so it's okay if you've forgotten, but we serve people 18 and older. But anyone can come to that housing command center. Just the other day, we had a mother with her two children. She did not speak English, and both her children were on the autism spectrum. And so we not only got a hold of translation services, but also we made sure those children had the resources they needed. And we helped that family get to primary health care, and we walked them through, walked alongside of them to make sure they got into stable housing. They had come on a bus. They had come from California, they were refugees and just weren't sure where to go, and they were told Central Iowa Shelter and Services was the place to be, so we helped them there. Well, we're bringing that Housing Command Center, we're bringing that to Atomo and Grinnell. Grinnell, we got the keys to our building last week, which is exciting. In Atomo, we plan to open up in 2025. But again, what that'll do is allow people in that area, because there are a lot of people in that area, even if you don't see them, they're there and they're experiencing homelessness. Again, making sure we can connect them to secure housing. It also works as an emergency shelter. If something's going on with an emergency weather event, which we've had several this year already, those facilities will be open to the public to utilize that for, again, safe shelter. All right, I've got a few more. Stay with me. We can do this. We also have a new program coming called The Weld. So this is actually an affiliate program with an organization up in Seattle. What we do is when people get out of the prison or jail system, often they go into transitional housing, they get a job that pays minimum wage, and then because they're fighting financially, they get right back into the cycle of trying to make ends meet, surviving, and making some choices that might not be legal, and then going back into the prison system. We want to help them stop that. So The Weld, we have a house where whenever they get out of the prison or jail system, they get right into housing. Part of that house is they pay a membership fee, which is in place of rent, which allows them to take care of utilities, laundry, meals, everything they need. But most importantly, we get them connected to a job right away, and that's mainly construction work. We know that that pays a thriving wage and not just surviving. It usually pays above $20 an hour. They get the skills they need to then get certified and get a job that, again, is going to keep them thriving and out of that cycle of going back into prison, so lowering the recidivism rate in our area. We came up with that program through going to Seattle, but also through another initiative we have, which is called the Lived Experience Coalition. All of these new programs we're starting, we're not sitting in a room making them up. We're working with individuals in this coalition that have lived experience, individuals that have been homeless or are actively homeless, individuals that are veterans, maybe they've been living with mental illness their entire lives, individuals that tell us what they needed and what they would have needed or could have needed or need right now to, again, get from that survival to that thriving mindset and that thriving stability. And we use the information they give us to make these decisions on what we're bringing to the area. We're actually helping them become their own nonprofit so that they're stable in their own, and we'll continue to consult them and have them help other nonprofits that help people in the community. Lastly, I'm sure there's more that I've forgotten because we have so many programs going on right now, but lastly, we're developing a social determinants of health application. It's called Bendel Companion. If you've seen in some old black and white movies, you'll see when they depict someone who's experiencing homelessness, they have a stick with a handkerchief that's holding all their belongings. That's called a Bendel. So this app is supposed to be the app that connects you to all the resources you need in the area. We're currently in what our developers call the alpha testing stage, which is where we have a group of individuals, including our Lived Experience Coalition, that are testing that application to make sure it works properly and make sure the user experience is correct. But then we're going to be going live here shortly in 2024. It's a wonderful application because most people have a phone. And if they don't, we also have a web-based platform, but they can get onto this app and it helps them learn how to navigate through our systems by themselves if they need to. We're working to go nationwide with it. So if they're in Iowa right now, but then they take a train or they get on a bus and they end up in a different state because they're trying to get back to their family, they can use that app to find resources right there in that community. It'll also help them understand that if they go into another medical clinic, they're not getting re-immunized, because that can be really hard on your system. It'll show, no, I got my flu shot here. I got my tetanus this time. Or, hey, I have diabetes and I really need my medication. Here's the information for my doctor. It's going to be a place where they can find community. So we're going to have local area organizations, nonprofit or for-profit, be able to say if they're having a community event where individuals experiencing homelessness are welcome. It's a really wonderful application. We're really excited to get it running and started. But again, we want to make sure that we're being as innovative as we can to connect people to what can help them thrive in our area. At CISS, we believe in the power of new beginnings. Our neighbors experiencing homelessness are part of our community, and it's our responsibility to support them in their time of need and this moment in their journey. Each program and service we offer is designed to address immediate needs while also empowering individuals to achieve long-term stability and success. Now, I've shared a lot today, but I bet some of you are wondering how you can help. We are always looking for volunteers within our food pantry, our clothing closet, processing donations, but our biggest need is always in the kitchen. Now, sometimes it can be difficult to provide meals. That can be expensive. You have to provide meals for 250 people. We completely understand. But even serving meals can help our kitchen crew and take off some of that burden for them, where they can take some time to clean up and prepare for another meal. So anytime you can come serve, we would love to have you. At the forum later, I'll have a volunteer sign-up sheet. And so if you're interested in volunteering, all you need to do is give us your name, email, and your phone number, and you'll be hearing from our team shortly to talk about the opportunities available. We know that together we can make a significant difference in the lives of these individuals going through just a rough moment in their lives. We hope that you can be a part of that and continue to be a part of that. You all have been so supportive to our organization for years, and we very much appreciate that from you. We love being here. We'd love to come talk anytime you'll have us. And I just want to say thank you again for this time and for your grace and giving me space to share our mission and everything that we do. I think I covered it all. Maybe. Thank you, guys.
I forgot to introduce the last one. Sorry. Please rise as you are able and join us in hymn number 315, This Old World, in your gray hymnal.
Join me in the chalice extinguishing words found in your order of service. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again. We leave this gathered community, but we don't leave our connection. Our concerns, our care for each other, our service to each other, to the world, and to our faith continues. Until we are together, together again, friends, be strong, be well, be true, be loving.